2020, the new apocalypse. A string of wildfires, crop-eating locust swarms, catastrophic typhoons, a global resurgence of civil rights protests, and continued political polarization marked the world in the shadow of a global healthcare crisis. However, amidst this disaster, we also witnessed a revelation. Confinement of life in a pandemic opened the door to new attitudes, behaviors, and values. Given this contrast, we could label 2020 as a new apocalypse. So what are the great lessons this 2020 apocalypse has revealed? While specific changes can easily be exaggerated, it is undeniable that 2020 will have a lasting impression. As experts in consumer behavior, we are often asked, what will come next, and what does it mean for my brand? Is this the new normal? Or will we go back to normal? What defines the post-2020 consumer? 2020 has not only forced us to stay inside, it also fundamentally changed how we seek and attain happiness, fostering a happiness reset. Based on the 7 universal human drivers of achieving happiness, we have identified 14 consumer trends for 2021.
Hello and welcome to the webinar. I'm coming at you live from an attic in the UK. It's great to have so many of you here on this, the third and final of our global trend briefings held over the last 24 hours. The peak of our performance, if you like, but with this time with the added risk of my kids interrupting the show. We're very excited to share our trend report with you today. But first, who are we and what makes our trend report worthy of your attention? Well, my name is Kelly McKnight. I head up the culture and trends team here at Insights Consulting. I am joined today by my colleagues Lily, Alice, and Yuri. We are part of a global team working in close collaboration with our research consultants to future-proof innovation, brand comms, and CX for our clients. We've been researching and applying trends for almost 10 years now and are passionate about making our trends not just inspiring, but truly actionable for our clients' brands. We do this through a unique mix of methodologies, placing human psychology at the center of our approach. As we all experienced, 2020 was a year of huge upheaval, and 2021 shows little sign of abatement. We began our research for the report with an exploration into this macro environment, mapping the forces of change impacting people's lives. These external factors are outside of our individual control. However, humans are incredibly adaptable and resilient. When the macro environment impacts our lives, we change course, recalibrating our expectations and finding new ways to meet our needs and further our individual and collective goals. As with apocalyptic events before, in 2020, we were motivated to find new ways to move forward. And there have been many attempts throughout history to explain human motivation. Since ancient times, philosophers like Aristotle have argued that people seek to attain a happy and tranquil life with the aim of maximizing their well-being. That humans are on a continuous quest to achieve happiness, and every action we take is ultimately in an attempt to make us happy. Building on centuries of philosophical observation and decades of scientific exploration, positive psychology shows us that there are 7 universal drivers which we seek to satisfy in order to achieve happiness and well-being. They are meaning, relationships, achievement, engagement, positive emotions, health, and security. Each driver is universal and always present in our lives, but the way we meet, in which we meet them can change over time in response to stimulus from the wider world. At the center of our approach then is our human drivers model, which encompasses the 7 universal drivers of human happiness and well-being. We use psychology to predict how people will respond to the changing external environment and seek new ways to achieve happiness. We explored and captured how each of the drivers is shifting in response to the upheaval of 2020 via the lives and experiences of the Illume Network, our proprietary network of leading edge consumers. Interviewing a broad range of Illume guides from around the world, we asked them to share their lives and perspectives with us. And we regularly collaborate with leading edge consumers on our network in this way, as they offer a unique glimpse into the future, instinctively opening themselves up to change and experimenting with new ideas and ways of doing things. And what we discovered is that 2020 not only forced us to stay inside, it also fundamentally changed how we seek and attain happiness through the seven drivers, supercharging existing cultural shifts and catalyzing a fundamental happiness reset. This, in turn, led us to the identification of 14 trends, or new and visible consumer behaviors that each leverage one or more of the drivers to make us happy. As researchers, we've gone a step further than most, working with our field partner, Dynata, to robustly quantify these trends with 15,000 consumers in 60 markets around the world. Special thanks to Dynata for their support. Today, we're going to be sharing a selection of these trends and the data that sits behind them with you. But first, let's look at each of the seven drivers in turn to understand the underlying shifts and how happiness is being reset across the globe. So starting with meaning, humans benefit from having a higher purpose in life, whether that meaning is found via being a parent, participating in the community, or furthering a good cause. We need a reason for being that is bigger than self. The 2020 apocalypse led to a re-evaluation of our perspectives and roles. The lockdown gave people a moment to reflect on what to do next. It created a crisis of meaning. Post-2020, we will see a more knowledge-focused approach to attaining meaning in life emerging across the world. Beyond wokeness, this is about revisiting one's sense of identity and position with a lens of re-education to find meaning. Relationships is perhaps the most important driver of all. Humans need a breadth and depth of quality connections to others to survive and thrive. Loneliness is recognized as a killer, while good relationships correlate with longer and more fulfilled lives. Fueled by lockdown measures, our immediate relationships have intensified, while others have been pushed away. This has triggered a refocusing on the family and close ties as an essential source of belonging, connection, and comfort. Post-2020, the concept of chosen families will gain traction as we craft new family structures, including a prominent role for pets. This results out of both necessity to combat loneliness and the growing belief that we do not have to do the things the way we have always done them before. Achievement is our drive to accomplish. Setting a goal and achieving it releases the happiness hormone dopamine, making us feel good and keeping us motivated to continually strive for more. The pandemic has served as a period of reflection, with people exploring different ways to structure their routines in order to get done what they need, avoid unnecessary anxiety, and feel good about their accomplishments in the process. Post-2020, people will continue to evaluate how they are spending their time. We'll see the crafting of new rituals and routines that deliver stability and resilience in a fragile and changeable macro context. Engagement is our need for focus. When we are truly engaged in an activity, we reach a rewarding state of flow. This is when we have those creative leaps and find solutions to the problems that have been vexing us. The great pause of 2020 made it okay to slow down, to pay attention to our environment and engage in low-key activities. It also highlighted the limitations of digital for delivering truly engaging experiences. Post-2020, inspired by the psychological benefits and personal space experienced during confinement, people will increasingly seek out moments of deep fascination, sensory engagement and flow in their everyday lives. Positive emotions is our need for pleasure. Activities such as shopping, food indulgences and sex are all about accessing positive emotions. They are activities that produce serotonin, the happy hormone. It stabilizes our mood and provides feelings of well-being. Serotonin impacts the entire body and even helps with sleeping, eating and digestion. In the pandemic world, being physically and morally restricted has raised levels of anxiety and depression. It's essential for our overall health to find ways to combat this negativity and let off steam. Post-2020, on a quest to block out the relentless bad news cycle, people will proactively seek out moments of positivity wherever possible in order to fight negativity and protect their mental well-being. Health is not merely the absence of disease or infirmity. Rather, it's a state of complete physical, mental, and social well-being. Without good health, it becomes more difficult to further any of the other happiness drivers. The global COVID-19 crisis has demonstrated the stark health vulnerabilities in our society. We are only as strong as our weakest link. Health has become the number one priority, yet improving our health has become so complicated. Post 2020, people increasingly look to strip back the layers and create healthier habits, lifestyles, and environments that feel instinctively good for us. We'll seek out simpler, more accessible ways to feel healthy. Then on to our final driver, security. Security is our sense of safety, our need to feel free from danger or uncertainty. Insecurity can take many forms, from worries about personal income to concerns about the future of the planet. Due to the cracks in our financial, political, social, and health systems, worry has become a part of daily life for many. Post 2020, we'll see a greater focus on competence and compassion as benchmarks of trust. Going beyond speaking out and vague promises, people increasingly expect individuals, brands, and businesses to create practical, workable solutions to security issues. From our analysis of the driver shifts, we have then identified 14 global consumer trends that leverage psychology to deliver holistic happiness and well-being across mind, body, and soul. Trends that offer ways to free up the mind and develop ourselves. Here we have life coach, DIY everything, attentive experiences, wild and weird, reimagined interactions, and sentimental optimism. Ways to protect and celebrate our physical bodies, nurturing nature, fight for immunity, designing for resilience, at-home pleasure, and rebuilding trust. And finally, routes to a more purposeful and peaceful life, disentangling taboos, unapologetic activism, and neighborly networks. Lily, Alice, and Yuri will now deep dive into a selection of those trends, sharing data and insights from our study. I'll hand over to Lily now.
Thank you, Kelly. Hi, everyone. I'm Lily, and I'm a consultant in the Culture and Trends team. In this section, we'll take you on a deep dive into our trends on a global level, explaining how everything works, and then exploring a selection of the trends. Let's begin by looking at our global trends data. This map tells you where each trend is in its life cycle, and each quadrant represents a different level of attitudinal and behavioral adoption. I'll explain this in more detail. So in the bottom left corner, we have nascent trends, trends that have low attitudinal and behavioral adoption currently. Many of these trends represent more leading edge ways of thinking about culture and consumer life. So if you're looking to do something truly new with your brand or in your category, these trends could be a good place to start. Also, while some of these trends are nascent on a global level, when you cut the data by market, generation, or demographic, some of them actually move quadrant. So that's when the kind of data analysis starts to become really interesting. So then if we move along to the bottom right, we get to the emerging trends. And this is where we have high attitude but low behavior trends, meaning people are engaging with the trend as an idea, but they're not necessarily acting upon it in their lives yet. So for brands, they might be able to help consumers convert their viewpoints into actions here. And interestingly, unapologetic activism sits here, raising the question of whether brands should be thinking about being the change or taking a stance on the issues that consumers care about. We know it's a really complicated issue that is widely debated and is not as straightforward as that necessarily. And then top right we have expanding. And this is where we have high behavior and high attitude trends. So trends that are really having their moment now. You won't be surprised to see here the trend fight for immunity, given what's happening in the broader COVID situation. But we also know that the health and wellness movement has been growing for quite some time, and that immunity was already a hot topic pre-pandemic. But what we're seeing now is that that trend is peaking as a result of what's happened in 2020. Then if we go over to the top left, we have establishing trends. So these are only high behavior trends only. And these trends are the ones that are generally been accepted as a normal part of life by consumers. So for example, we have our rebuilding trust trend, and we know that trust, disinformation, and authenticity are pretty established cultural conversations around the world, but they remain really, really important to consumers and crucial for brands to be paying attention to. So now if we take a step back and look at the pattern overall, we can see that the trends that feel closer to home, so trends like neighborly networks, nurturing nature, or at-home pleasures, are really important to people right now. And this reflects the kind of precarious situation that we all find ourselves in, as well as the well-being driven mindset that we're seeing coming through as people try to feel good and feel happy despite what's going on in the macro world. Then when we look at the more emerging and nascent part of the map, we can see the more disruptive trends. So trends like disentangling taboos. And these are the trends that are really focused on proactively pushing society and brands to be bolder and to challenge the status quo. And while our currently fragile mindset might not be ready to kind of go full force on these trends en masse right now, they are underpinned by much longer term, bigger social and societal shifts. So we expect them to continue to grow in importance into the future. So hopefully that gives you a sense of the bigger picture. Now we'll take you through a few of our trends in more detail. So first up, we have neighborly networks. And this trend is all about consumers recognizing the value of community ties, specifically in their local areas. Neighborly networks has been accelerated by COVID and delivers on both our relationship and security human drivers. And what we're seeing is the rise of networks and platforms that enable local communities to tackle growing concerns like education gaps, food gaps, loneliness, and sustainability. And brands across all sectors can play a role here via local partnerships or through upskilling schemes that support specific communities or small businesses. And on the next slide, I'll take you through some of the data that sits behind this trend. So the map you can see on the left shows the same quadrants that I've already explained, but with a market lens applied. So we can see here that Australia and the US are expanding for neighbouring networks, whereas the trend is more nascent in China and South Korea. And this reflects cultural and contextual differences in each of those different markets. For example, China's greater focus on national identity and collectivism rather than on local community. If you look at the top right of the slide, you can see that neighbourly networks has a relatively high global trend score of 73%. And the global trend score is the percentage of people who have a positive attitude and or behaviour for this particular trend. And the next gen score that you can see below that is the score for Gen Z and millennials, so for the youngest consumer groups. And in this case, it's slightly higher than the global average. And this makes sense because we know that today younger people have found that their social connections and social ties have been disrupted in 2020. And into the future, we can expect them to be looking to establish them in new and creative ways. And then finally, we have the top three sectors that were identified by consumers as current playing fields for this trend. And here, groceries comes out top, followed by retail and leisure. And let's look into that a bit further via a couple of examples. So food naturally brings people together, and cuisine has long been what binds cultures and creates shared social identities. So it's really interesting to see a lot of innovation happening in the food sector around local in the recent months and years. And one example is the Italian drinks brand Comunità Frizzante, who are engaging community by working with local producers to create new flavors and harvest ingredients, and then also working with local experts and chefs to mix those flavors together, come up with interesting new combinations and distribute them in interesting ways around the local area. But it's not just local heroes that are engaging with neighborly networks, it's also global brands. And Burger King is a great example of that. Burger King recently partnered with a low league UK football club, Stevenage FC, in a FIFA campaign. And they follow this up with a supporting campaign around for the club's female team as well, with their Burger Queen campaign. And this partnership was really successful because it amplified the voice of an underdog team across a worldwide platform, but it also showed how Burger King are willing to recognize the power of local engagement and a more kind of innovative grassroots approach to sponsorship and partnership. Then finally for this trend, we have the growing world of food service platforms. So from Deliveroo to Gojek, this is a space that is really growing dramatically around the world. The example I wanted to highlight was the Filipino ride hailing app Ancus. And Ancus launched a food delivery service throughout lockdown to provide income for their bikers, allowing them 100% of the profits. And more broadly, Ancus positioned themselves as an employee-centric brand, putting out lots of positive stories around their riders and putting that very much at the heart of their brand message. And overall, I think for this trend, a key learning is that brands should be thinking about ways to lift up communities in creative ways and bring people together with creative, systemic and platform solutions. This is a great way to create a more emotional connection rather than a transactional one. Next, I'm going to explain a little bit more about the trend designing for resilience. This trend is rooted in our health and security driver and is expanding globally. Designing for resilience is all about feeling protected from outside forces and building resilient mindsets. This trend has been accelerated by COVID, but was already growing massively amid global fears around climate change and political and social instability. And brands can really help here by creating solutions that make consumers feel safe and secure via new innovations, designs, and systems that address issues like mental health, hygiene, or urban pollution. Let's have a little look at the data behind this. So for this trend, on a market view, Brazil and the Philippines score particularly high, for example, while Germany finds that the adoption rate is low overall. And there's a number of kind of factors that will be playing into this, one being perhaps that Germany has a relatively stable socioeconomic situation right now versus other markets, but there may be a number of other kind of cultural implications at play as well. For the global trend score overall, though, this is a really high scoring trend at 81%, with a slight increase again for next gen, which is, of course, reflective of the kind of anxieties that we know young people in particular face and think about when it comes to climate change and financial futures as well. And then we have the top three playing fields for this sector. And here, healthcare and finance and groceries come out top. And let's explore that through a couple of different examples. So Cigna is a global healthcare insurance company, and they recognized that a lot of their customers were expressing feelings of anxiety. So they commissioned a study into resilience specifically, and they found some kind of quite intense results where people were feeling very, very anxious. So they made it their mission to improve people's well-being by making healthcare simple, affordable, and predictable. And targeting Americans specifically, they've launched a range of different resources and initiatives designed to reframe stress and support resilience. Next up, we have an example from South Africa. So Space Pace is a new app designed to help women feel safe when walking or running alone at nighttime. And this South African app is part of a much bigger global conversation around designing for female needs. The best-selling book, Invisible Women, which was published in 2019, suggests that male bias in design is threatening the safety of women around the world, and suggests that we need to find better ways to design systems and experiences that prioritize female needs and help them to feel safe and to live more resilient lives. So thank you for listening so far. I'll hand over now to Alice to tell you a little bit more about a few more trends.
Brilliant, thank you, Lily. So next up, we're going to look into unapologetic activism, an emerging trend rooted in our meaning and relationship drivers. More recently, consumers around the world have been exposed to visible systematic injustices, causing a real spark to act and drive reforms of societal ideas and systems that are not inclusive of all. So this is creating opportunities for brands that are uniquely positioned to positively impact a cause or a community. The key thing here is gaining trust with consumers, and it's really fundamental to use an authentic voice when calling out relevant issues specific to local markets. And also about being sensitive to cultural nuances. For example, in more nascent markets, it's less about striking and marching on the streets, and instead about using your voice to push for change in more subtle ways. On the next slide, we have our quant headlines. So when we cut the data by market, we can see that this is expanding in markets such as Brazil, South Africa, and Germany, whereas markets such as Indonesia, this is much more subtle and less politicized. On the top right, we have the global trends score, and that's at 72 here, with a next gen score of 73%. The relevant sector playing fields identified are media and entertainment at 25%, followed by fashion and finance and insurance. So a real mix of sectors. Interestingly though, the highest score goes to no sector at 41%. So there's a ripe opportunity to do something really different and disruptive from a brand perspective. So let's take a look at some of the brands who are doing interesting things in this space already. As I said, from our quant data, we saw Brazil is ahead in some markets moving into that more expanding space. And an example to illustrate unapologetic activism in Brazil is Confinada, translating to confined. And they are a comic book strip published regularly on Instagram. They've used the pandemic to really illustrate issues of racism, sexism, and structural inequality happening in Brazil right now. So an interesting example of how a media publication are using their platform to call out injustice. On the next slide, we move to the world of fashion with US fashion brand Visa Issues. And their collection is inspired by streetwear, politics, and language used towards immigrants. The owner herself has experienced this. The collection includes a green card lottery military jacket and colours featured by employment authorisation IDs. So this is a really nice example of using visual cues to make a statement. The final brand that I'm going to share with you for this trend is from MasterCard. They launched their True Name initiative as part of their Acceptance Matters campaign. And this allowed chosen names and titles to feature on the front of bank cards. But here, MasterCard are not only holding themselves accountable, but also calling on the industry as a whole to ensure people's financial products reflect their true identities. Moving on to the next trend now, we have disentangling taboos. So at present, this is a nascent trend rooted in our meaning and relationship drivers. So consumers aren't necessarily acting on this trend right now, as Lily explained, but there is a wider long-term shift, such as the inclusivity movement, that suggests this could grow in the longer term. So consumers are seeking knowledge, understanding, and true portrayals of personal topics previously deemed uncomfortable. So here we're talking about taboos like poverty, disability, and the menopause. Brands can play a really important role here by identifying, educating, and uplifting social stigmas. Here, real-life storytelling and visually raw campaigns will really help actively challenge societal norms and the current status quo. Let's dive into the data for this one. So more prominent markets are the UK, Germany, and France, as you can see in the bottom left there. So more common in European markets right now. In China, this is much less developed. And we as a team can help you understand the cultural nuances that sit behind this. Moving to the top right for the global trend score, we have 59% here. We then have a slightly higher score for next gen, so those younger demographics, at 63%. And this is a reflection of how younger generations are constantly challenging and disrupting norms with honest conversations on inclusivity. The relevant sector playing fields identified here are media and entertainment, followed by fashion and beauty. So traditionally, those more liberal categories. Similar to unapologetic activism, the highest score actually goes to no sector here. So this leaves it wide open once again for brand disruption and innovation. But let's look at some of the brands who are currently occupying this more emergent and nascent space. So death is often an uncomfortable topic for many of us, and sadly something that we've all been forced to hear more about and confront as a result of the pandemic. There's been much more honest and open discussions about death in the media. One example being Surviving Death, an American documentary series that premiered on Netflix this month. And this explores ideas of near-death experiences, life after death, and the psychic mediumship. These personal stories have really struck a chord with global audiences on a mainstream platform. Another example now, so we have Neiwai, a premium Chinese lingerie brand, and they've been challenging narrow cultural expectations of Chinese bodies to celebrate the diversity of women and their supposed flaws. Released ahead of International Women's Day last year, Neiwai's campaign No Body is No Body featured six women that you can see on screen there, sharing their body insecurities on WeChat and Weibo. By putting female insecurities under the spotlight, it really connected with audiences on an intimate level, so a very relatable campaign. The final brand I'm going to share with you for disentangling taboos is Lloyds Bank. So they ran a campaign in the UK that encouraged people to talk about their financial anxiety and concerns to break money taboos, especially in families. The campaign was created in response to research from Lloyds Bank showing that money is actually a bigger taboo in British families over politics, sex, and religion. That may be surprising or unsurprising for the British people listening right now. And this is a topic that's being tackled much more openly, especially outside of the home. You'll see in the top right there that there was a New York Times article published recently showing how women are having more honest conversations about money in the workplace and really pushing for salary transparency. So that summarizes that disentangling taboos is currently a nascent trend, but there is an emerging shift that suggests there's a role for brands to play when it comes to tackling societal taboos. I'll now hand over to Yuri, who will share three more trends that were significantly more present amongst next-gen audiences.
Thank you, Alice. I will focus on three of the four trends, of which our global quant results showed us they were significantly more present, indeed, among both Generation Z and Millennials, when we compare them to the 40-plus population. One overall conclusion is that the majority of these specific next-gen trends seem to be related to the mind. This is confirming the increased importance of mental well-being for these younger generations who perhaps are struggling the most with missing out on social contacts and life milestone celebrations due to the pandemic. So the first trend I would like to address is called DIY Everything, and it's driven by an increased need for expressing individuality along with a strong shift towards more sustainable living. And the pandemic has definitely accelerated both needs as consumers in general, and especially the younger ones, are re-evaluating their ikigai. DIY offers control over used ingredients or processing methods, as well as carbon footprint, while the active engagement in new skills gives a sense of purpose and achievement.
I've done a bit of home baking this week with the kids, and Stella's really into space travel. So I've made some space-themed biscuits.
Oh, nice.
So here you go.
Nice.
She's really happy with these. So here's the stars.
Oh,
they're nice little.
They're cute.
Yeah. And here's the moon. Mm-hmm. You see that little?
It's the moon.
And here's the space rocket.
The what?
So that's Maltesers Mars brand take on the DIY everything trend. Although at this point, the trend is still nascent among most global markets, even among Generation Z and Y, we can already witness a move towards establishing in France, Germany, Belgium, and the Netherlands. This means that brands across categories should start creating platforms and tools to collaborate with consumers in making hyper-personalized products and services. This is not only relevant in home cooking or home improvement projects, which of course gain more attention as we have spent more time at home, but also other sectors can benefit from this trend. So Generation Z combines style, craft, and a thrifty attitude, which led to the fast growth of re-commerce platforms such as Vinted, Depop, and ThredUp. Obviously, like we just saw, TikTok is the social platform to pick up DIY trends, such as the cardigan challenge. The color block patchwork cardigan that Harry Styles wore during a gig in The Tonight Show was designed by British fashion label GW Anderson, and it originally retailed for more than $1,500 or £1,250. In response to the garment's popularity among more than 40 million users on TikTok, Jonathan Anderson, the founder and head of design of GW Anderson, released a detailed PDF guide that includes instructions and a pattern for the sweater. That's a good example of how fashion brands and brands in general are no longer dictating collections, but rather giving control to consumers themselves. Jewelry brand Waltz allows its customers to create their own unique bracelets, offering a wide variety of beads, pearls, and threads. Sustainable fashion brand Rayburn partnered with Depop to offer material and patterns for a reversible DIY bucket hat for free in return for a social media post of the design. In South Africa, homeware store Leroy Merlin is using Facebook to post short DIY tutorial videos, stimulating its customers to use leftover materials and create their own designs on a budget. But the DIY everything trends playfield is much wider than fashion and home improvement. Non-alcoholic spirit brand Seedlip created a compostable gift box and added gift tags infused with thyme seeds to start growing your own herbs at home. Spanish plant-based skincare brand Rouse has a line of raw natural ingredients. The website shares DIY recipes and sells ceramic equipment for home mixing. With rising COVID-19 related unemployment around the world, ambitious DIY projects can turn into successful micro enterprises. In the US, at the end of October 2020, there were 40% more new business applications compared to the same period in 2019. And when Nick Bryan lost his job as a chef in Florida, he started Pasta Packs, a local fresh pasta meal kit delivery service. In fighting a burnout, Dutchie Thijs van Impe became one of the many successful sneaker personalizers, selling customized hand-painted Nike Airs for an average of 500 euros. And in Rio de Janeiro, to the bottom right side of the slide, Valtinea Macado started a driving flower shop in a 1969 VW Beetle after her previous business had collapsed because of the pandemic. So that was the first trend related to next gen. We move on to the next one, and that's called reimagined interactions. Reimagined interactions is already in an expanding stage with next gens, while still being nascent with the 40 plus population. In the past year, most of us had to find new ways of organizing our social interactions with friends, relatives, co-workers, or co-students for the younger ones. But as consumers are spending more time on screens than ever before, and the real digital detox would finally be welcome, travel, mobility, and socializing restrictions will ask for reimagined interactions at least until fall. This meme, Remember Concerts, reminds us of how we are craving for real life entertainment in the end. And many live events and artists have been looking for open air spaces for corona-proof performances or creating 6 feet distance formats like the Flaming Lips did in a literally bubbly concert last October with both audience and band members in inflatable bubbles. Social distancing also led to a revival of drive-in cinemas, with the biggest drive-in theater in the world, Lighthouse 5 in Florida, planned to open with 5 screens in 2023. Meanwhile, also in the US, Lexus organized a branded 3-day culinary drive-in cinema with a 3-course gourmet meal. And why not use the same concept for other occasions? Drive-in raves such as Auto Disco in Germany, or drive-in art like the Van Gogh exhibitions in Toronto, Canada. What about floating cinemas, even in gondolas in Manila, in the Philippines, in Darling Harbour in Sydney, or maybe sponsored by your brand, like the ice cream brand Häagen-Dazs has done in Paris and in London. Airlines were also reimagining in-flight dining, with Thai Airways cabin crew serving meals in its Bangkok headquarters, repurposing unused plane chairs, while Singapore Airlines used a grounded Airbus A380 at Changi Airport to offer first-class, business, and economy meals ranging from $470 to only $40. And with no foreign visitors present in Budapest, Michelin awarded chef Kostas reinvented the wheel by using the Budapest Eye Ferris wheel to serve a 4-course dinner. While all these creative attempts to create new and safe in real life experiences in a 6 feet society were very welcomed, digital events, social media, and online commerce will definitely play a much bigger role in social life than ever before. Gaming spaces are transforming to virtual third places, or actually we should call them second places, as for many of us, home and work have merged in the meantime. Fortnite's Party Royale not only offered virtual concerts, but also a series of in-game conventions, such as We the People, More Than a Vote, which is a series or was a series of conversations between athletes and entertainers to empower young adults of color to vote for the US elections. In October, Xola launched Unconventional. That's the platform to the right lower corner of the slide. And it's a platform for virtual events with 3D avatars in virtual worlds. Few months earlier, TO was successfully launched with business meetings, film festivals, record releases, birthday parties, conferences, and even book launches already taking place in a totally virtual setting. And again, this opens perspectives for brands. Like, for instance, Heineken. Heineken, with its Tiger Beer, created a virtual street food festival for Malaysian consumers, allowing them to create their own avatar, with which they could tour the streets, but also order food and drinks for real home delivery. They could also engage in playing a treasure game, a hunt game, to earn happy hour promotions in this virtual setting. Singapore Bank DBS recreated the iconic Zouk nightclub inside the Fortnite game to attract younger customers for the Live Fresh credit card. Net-a-Porter presented an exclusive virtual capsule collection in Nintendo's Animal Crossing, and Johns Hopkins University in the US gave free Minecraft access to all enrolled students and organized official school events, such as the annual Hoptoberfest inside the game. With socializing becoming increasingly virtual, social and online commerce are also definitely on the rise. VW Australia created an augmented reality experience to help customers not only customize, but also really buy their vehicles online. And this was launched with a 28 centimeter high or low, I should say, miniature reproduction of a real dealership last October. Kia, competitor of Volkswagen, created on-demand demos and a live Q&A last summer to offer clients in the Middle East and South Africa a live stream showroom. So live commerce, which was already very popular in Asian markets, is now really going global because of the pandemic. In China on Singles Day, Taobao's live platform had 30 different live stream sales channels, each of them generating almost $15 million of revenue only on that single Singles Day. L'Oreal is using the live scale e-commerce platform for makeup tutorials and also to interact with shoppers through a live Q&A. And Petco, which is involved with pet care and pet food products, a retailer, is using Instagram, as you can see to the left side of the screen, to add live vet advice to its pet food and pet care range. Another aspect of reimagined interactions is the global out of office, leading to blurring lines between our office, our homes, and getaway, which we also know as digital nomadism. Overseas professionals can now apply for a one-year remote working visa to live in Dubai while remaining employed abroad. Barbados, Iceland, Bermuda, Estonia, Croatia, and Georgia have similar offers. European tourism group TUI test launched a workation B2B approach, selecting hotel rooms located in quiet areas and equipped with ergonomic desks and chairs, as well as high performance internet. And a similar trend can be found among students, the youngest generation. For many Gen Zers, the path to adulthood, including education plans, has been disrupted by the pandemic. And many have been pushed back into dependent living with their parents, but others have been renting off-campus collab houses, doing school remotely together. In the US, aplacebeyond.com recently transformed sites normally used as American summer camps into learning communities with a tailored schedule of guided outdoor recreation, soft skill workshops, and academic and emotional support. So that was the second next-gen trend, and now we move to the very last one we will discuss during this presentation. And again, it's also related to people spending more time at home. This makes them eager to improve their interior and exterior, adding new functions such as fitnessing or relaxing in the home spa, not wanting to compromise on luxurious and rewarding me time while being confined. This, of course, creates opportunities for brands that bring those type of me moments into the home. Consumers are looking for new ways to engage in highly pleasurable experiences in a familiar environment. So this trend is globally expanding, with consumers spending money they would normally spend on holidays or going out now to staying in, with a focus on home improvement and luxury in different home, in-home related categories. Some examples. In the past year, consumer demand for large screen TVs has continued to grow rapidly, as they're not only using the TV to replace the out-of-home cinema experience, but also to digitally connect with yoga teachers or relatives during aperitivos together apart. With Samsung's ultra-large 110-inch micro-LED dubbed The Wall, first launched in South Korea, the brand offers a breathtaking visual experience, redefining what premium at-home experiences mean for affluent consumers around the world. And in China, luxury jewelry brand Cartier has launched a range of objects that can add a touch of luxury to your home. Showcasing four collections, Cartier responds to the desires to bring joy and beauty into our lockdown lives. Amazon Prime Video is using a reality TV format to sell a limited run of the luxury fashion collection that was featured in the Making the Cut fashion-focused TV show. And luxury personal care products adding CBD oil benefits to the wellness experience are also on the rise, with prestige hair care treatments are also having a very strong increase, plus 30% in sales. There's one example on this slide in the bottom right corner. It's Dr. Barbara Sturm's Super Anti-Aging Serum. And this one is retailed at nearly 300 euros for only 30 milliliter small bottle. So very luxurious. And then lastly, more than 11 million US households have adopted a pet during the pandemic, according to the American Pet Product Association. The Dog Trust in the UK had to tweak its famous Christmas slogan after they found out that online searches for getting a puppy more than doubled during the first lockdown. So consumers are globally looking for an extra companion at home, and that leads to a steep growth in related categories such as pet grooming and pet food, with even Unilever's Ben & Jerry's launching doggy desserts. Human-centric personal care brands have also entered the pet grooming space, with consumers trusting the brands they trust for their own use, like Burt's Bees, also for their newest family members. And with this cute last visual, you're ending this overview of seven of the 14 consumer 2021 trends that our culture and trends team has kindly prepared for you. Remember, you will find seven more of these trends explained in the full report you will get after this event.